But in school, like, there is kind of a point where I thought, right, wow, I can do this. In about fourth year in school, I was part of the student representative body, and one of our jobs was to organize fundraisers for the school, one of them being school discos. And we got let down a day or so before by a DJ, about a day before one of the school discos. And we didn't know who to buy. We couldn't get anybody on short notice. And I had a really big CD collection at the time, because I just collected every type of music you can think of. And about a year prior to that, I had started to get into dance music. So I was just like hoovering up anything that I could get my hands on locally in terms of CDs. And I'd do a weekly trip up to Dublin to try and get CDs that I couldn't get in Carlow. You know, I was obsessive about collecting music. So I said, look, how hard can it be? I'll give it a go. So I stood in for the DJ, didn't have a clue what I was doing, but was just sucked in immediately by, I was always interested in being on stage. I used to do a lot of acting, a lot of drama. I sang at that time in a band. So I just wanted to be on stage. I knew I loved that, but this, the whole idea of being on stage, and I had a microphone as well. So like, I thought I was a combination of Carl Cox and Maxim from The Prodigy, you know, so I was emceeing as well. But just looking at like 400 of my schoolmates reacting to what I was doing, even though I knew deep down I didn't have a clue what I was doing, was just the bug, that cliche bug that bit me. And while I didn't think it was a career at that stage, I thought this is something I want to do and I want to continue doing.
What was the point when you thought, I have actually arrived in this arena, in this space?
I probably still, James, haven't come to that point. But there are one or two moments where I thought, right, this is much bigger than I had realized. Because you're so close to everything, it's just very incremental. You know, it's just day by day, taking it easy. But there have been gigs. I remember my first big international gig was a festival, and we're going back to like 07, 08 here. It was Summer of Love in Pardubice, just outside Prague in the Czech Republic. And I had an agent at that point and a manager, and all of a sudden these gigs started to come on stream. I remember looking at a crowd of thousands for the first time who actually knew what I did. And I had no kind of peripheral awareness that anyone would know me outside of Ireland. And even then, I wasn't really sure, because when you have a radio audience in Ireland, obviously you're getting feedback on the radio, but you don't really know. And I remember promoting gigs in the academy over the years, and the only gig, even though I had a really successful dance music brand, Letric, which was, along with Planet Love, were probably one of the two preeminent dance brands in the country, and we were doing a lot of big stuff, and it started to promote outside Ireland. Promotion was never something that I enjoyed. It was a means to an end. In fact, it was a major headache. I learned a lot from it, but I mean, for every gig that you'd make money on, you'd lose money on five. You know, it's a really tough game. When COVID-19 hit, I've seen a lot of people kind of drop off, people who weren't maybe adaptable or hadn't planned for any kind of reinvention. I've done it three times within DJing and production. I mean, I started off as a commercial DJ, reinvented myself as a dance DJ, and then did it again with the more commercial side of things. So to adapt to a changing scenario, and for gigs to disappear for the first time since I did that first gig that I've already mentioned in school, for this type of period of time. I mean, I've never had a 2 week period where I haven't done a gig, never. So to look back on 6 months where I haven't had one is really tough, but I choose to look at the positives, and I've doubled down on the studio side of things and the amount of music that's being made now without distraction. Not the gigs were a distraction, they're my first love, but to not be tired on a Monday after a weekend of gigs and extending into a Tuesday, and to hit the ground running in the studio every single day. Just to give a bit of background, when it came to production, my attitude, I saw so many people within trance using ghost producers, essentially having somebody make the music for them and they buy the tracks or whatever, put their name to it. I don't actually have a problem with that, each to their own. If you have two people who are willing to have that working relationship, grand. I didn't want to do that though, because whilst I realized that to learn the craft, if you want, was a much, much longer road, I also knew that I had these other musical itches, to go back to that term, that I wanted to scratch at some point, or may want to scratch. So I wanted to be able to adapt. I've always been like that in my life. I've always wanted a plan B, a fallback, if you like, even if I had no intention of ever using it, I wanted it to be there. So it was the same with production. So while I was producing and learning to produce trance, techno, tech trance, that side of stuff, I wanted to get to a level where I knew I could someday flip that.
One last thing. Will we see it, or do you want to see a John Gibbons number one, like a Swedish House Mafia, David Guetta type of chain smokers type of hit? Is that in the pipeline, in your dreams or in your plan to try to get there to have a massive hit?
Yeah. We will see one. We will. The music is there. The music's constantly evolving. I'm obviously getting better. I'm a firm believer that the minute I think I know everything is the minute I should give up, because that's when I'll stop growing. As a person, as an artist, I mean, that extends to life in general. It's just the way I look at things. So maybe it'll be in 2 weeks' time. Maybe it'll be in 2 years. Maybe it'll be in 20 years. I don't know when, but I really feel it will happen. And not just one. There'll be loads.